Almighty God, we give you thanks and praise for the opportunity to be gathered here today as we begin our Lenten journey. Open our hearts and minds to receive your word in Jesus Christ, your Son, who stared down the cross in the wilderness to take it up upon himself for us. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Over 30 years ago, I participated in Lutheran campus ministries at the University of Texas in Austin when I was an undergraduate student. Early on, I worshiped regularly and I participated in Bible study. However, as I became more immersed in the wilderness of campus life and all the temptations universities offer young people, my engagement with Lumen, as it was known, declined. I was struggling to discern my vocation, my very identity. Pastor Kirk Johnson at Lumen was a lovely man, but I remember thinking he was probably so old and sanctified, he couldn't possibly understand my struggles. Looking back, he probably wasn't much older than I am now. I couldn't recall the last time I had attended church when I received a special invitation to Sunday morning worship, where Pastor Johnson had an important announcement to make. Wilderness spaces, like university campuses, can be ones of deep introspection and learning, but also ones of doubt and troubling temptation. In today's gospel, the Spirit leads Jesus into just such a wilderness space. He has not wandered unawares from the beaten path, but has been led intentionally by the Spirit into the wilderness to discern his vocation. Jesus is wrestling with what kind of leader, Messiah, he is called to be. This is a question of his very identity. In this period of contemplation, the devil emerges with temptations. And I imagine this devil, a word derived from diabolos, less a physical being, but more like diabolically intrusive thoughts flooding his brain as the human and the divine in his personhood confront one another. It's through this confrontation that Jesus becomes prepared to minister to the harsh world that awaits him. This is a world that loves bold, splashy entrances, like magically turning stones into bread. The type of idol-making act that breeds devoted acolytes, but is essentially self-serving to one's ego. This is a world of Caesars that remake God into their own image, worshiping glory over humility, strength over vulnerability, domination over servitude. This is a world that questions and challenges the very existence of divine love's presence by its own standards and demands God make God's self known on those terms. Jesus is struggling with what it will mean for him to be the Son of God in this world. Jesus is staring down the cross. There are times in our life when we are led by the Spirit to enter wilderness spaces to discern who we are and how we are called to live our lives. It could be a physical space such as a university or those mental spaces of time during life's many transitions. Those times when we're embarking on a new professional journey or starting a family, becoming empty nesters or entering retirement, or facing the inevitable transition we all will, death, moving from this life into the next. Failure, or fear of failure by human standards of success, can be crippling for us, leaving us with feelings of shame, unworthiness, resentment, or doubt. Whether we're looking back on the life we have lived, are ahead to an uncertain future. This harsh world tempts us to turn away from divine love and towards self-promoting temptations that feed our egos. It's a world that tempts us to opt out with illicit substances or people-pleasing behaviors instead of engaging in the hard, vulnerable work of the contemplative life. It's a world that worships achievement and affluence, the lifestyles of the rich and famous that tempt us from magazine covers and social media to believe that anything other is weak, less than, not enough. Our world challenges divine love to show up on those terms, and therefore tempts us to believe, as Frederick Denker suggests, that if all is going well in our lives through human eyes, then God is on our side, and if not, that invites us to question our very identity. In these wilderness moments, grappling with worldly temptation, like Jesus, we are staring down the cross. Jesus enters the wilderness space and, in staring down the cross, becomes sanctified to bear it. The warring thoughts in his head acknowledge from the start his identity. He is the Son of God. The beginning of these devilish provocations, if you are the Son of God, would best be rendered, since you are the Son of God, for in the Greek it is not a conditional statement. The question for Jesus then is, what will that mean for him? As scholar Malcolm Muggeridge writes, Satan is offering Jesus the chance to be that thundering Messiah we think we want. We want anything but a suffering Messiah. And so did Jesus at one level. However, through his sanctifying wilderness experience, Jesus realizes there are no shortcuts to achieving God's will for humankind or the purpose of his earthly ministry. As Philip Yancey suggests, goodness cannot be imposed externally from the top down. It must grow internally from the bottom up. This process of sanctification is defined by scholar Daniel Migliori as, first of all, the gift of God, and only then, also, a human calling. Wilderness times of sanctification are marked by the Word of God, prayer, and freedom of choice. Jesus grows in clarity of God's plan for his earthly ministry by mining his sculptural tradition for sustaining guidance and prayerfully dispelling Satan's temptations to self-satisfaction, self-importance, self-seeking. The divine love of Jesus Christ freely chooses dying to self for the sake of the world. Jesus stares down the cross and in doing so discerns his vocation then as servant leader, prepared for the ministry challenges that lay ahead. Jesus stares down the cross so that he might take up the cross for us, securing our identity as God's beloved children, so that we too, through his grace, might bear our own crosses and those of our neighbor. When diabolic intrusive thoughts tempt you to believe that you are not enough, divine love says, your self-worth is found in me. When this devilish world tempts you with its false narratives of failure and success, God says, I provide all you need. When you stare down the cross in the wilderness times of your own life, divine love of Jesus Christ that wrestled with and triumphed over temptation says, you are not alone. Your identity as God's beloved child is secured by the grace of Jesus Christ. It is not if you are a child of God, but since you are a child of God, take up your cross and follow Jesus as a servant leader to this suffering world. This Lent season, we are led by the Spirit into a wilderness journey to grow in Christian love through word, prayer, prayer, and our freedom to choose to follow Jesus. Which leads me back to that fateful Sunday morning in 1993 when I arrived at Lutheran Campus Ministries for Sunday morning worship and Pastor Kurt Johnson's big announcement. Following the blessing, Pastor Johnson let his young congregation know that he was dying of brain cancer and had little time left to live. He graciously and patiently explained his diagnosis, which he had taken time to accept. He wanted us to know that sometimes he felt scared, but he knew to whom he belonged and to whom he was going. Above all, he wanted us to know, each and every one of us, that we were loved. He wanted us to know that God loved each of us despite how much we might doubt, and that there was nothing that could ever separate us from God's love. Our identity as God's beloved children was secured through the grace of Jesus Christ. I realized that morning, this pastor knew exactly what I had been struggling with. Because of the gift of Jesus Christ in his life, Pastor Johnson knew his identity was secured. Therefore, he was able to stare down his own cross, take it up, and follow in the way of his Lord as servant leader, loving and caring for his very young flock until the very end. So too, may we follow Christ in this way. Jesus goes before us into the wilderness, stares down the cross in order to graciously take it upon himself for us, God's beloved children. Therefore, let us take up our own crosses and follow.